Okay, so I'll just do a quick recap of last week. In the sense, what I've done is I've put up some solutions. So up on the website, there is, I'll go through this very briefly, a discussion of the parallelization of the traffic model. I've given up some parallel implementations in OpenMP, which is the thread-based parallelism model, and in MPI, which you can play around with if you want, and some sample results from the fractal exercise. And the lecture slides and exercises for this week are up there. So the first thing I was going to do was just briefly go through the cellular automaton exercise just to discuss the parallelization strategy. I'll go through this quite quickly, but the traffic simulation, if you go through the mechanics of it, the important point is it's a cellular automaton where each cell depends on its two neighbors. So you have three states. The cell is up neighbor and it's down neighbor. So you need eight rules because there are eight possible initial states and you want to have the output value. And the rules are quite simple if you write them out in a tabular form like this. On the left-hand side, if initially a cell is full, if the upward neighbor is full, then it can't move and so it stays there. But if the upward neighbor is empty, then the cell becomes empty. And then the other case, the other four cases are if the current cell is empty, if the upward cell is full, it stays empty. If the downward cell if the current cell is empty, your state only depends on your downward neighbor. If the downward neighbor is full, you become full. That's the top case and the middle case, and otherwise you stay as you are. So you can sort of write. So although we thought about the model as moving the cars, moving the cells. Formally, it's just an update rule. You give the new state based on the eight possible values of the old state. And so there's a state table there, the same thing as previously. But the pseudocode, I think I gave you actual code last time, but we declare these arrays. We initialize them possibly randomly. We loop over the iterations. And the first important step is we're simulating the traffic on a roundabout, which means we have periodic boundary conditions. So although the actual cells are numbered 1 to n, we have these ghost or boundary cells, 0 and n plus 1, which we copy to be equal to the simplest way to do this example is to use this treatment for the boundary conditions, where we close the circle of the roundabout by setting old of 0 to be old of n, and old of n plus 1 to be equal to old of 1. So the neighbor up from old of n is old of n plus 1, but it's been set to be old of 1, which effectively completes the boundary conditions. Then we loop over the cells, and although there are eight cases, there's only four rules there, because there's this degeneracy that if your cell is full, your state only depends on your upward neighbor, and if the cell is empty, the state only depends on the downward neighbor. So, and then we copy back for the next iteration. Just basic comments on this. If we want to parallelize this model using threads, load balance isn't an issue. So that the fractals example is to investigate the issue of load balance, where different threads or different processors have different amounts of work to do. But here, if we just split the road of length n into equal size of size p, where we have, say, p threads, p cores, then that's not a problem. The rule for cell I depends on cells I minus 1 and I plus 1. And so we can actually parallelize this update loop over I equals 1 to n completely, because the left-hand side is old and the right-hand side is new. So we're updating a new array based on an old array. So there's no clashes there in updating. If we split the loop over I amongst different threads, although we're sometimes reading the same value as another thread, because we're reading the value of old of I and old of I minus 1 and old of I plus 1, we might be reading values that other cells are reading. Simultaneously reading values isn't a problem. It's simultaneously writing values which is a problem. So because we're all operating on a different value of I, then when we update new of I, then there's no conflicts. But we need certain synchronization. As I said last week, the synchronization is key to the correctness of all programs, but particularly programs done in the shared variables threaded model. So we need to ensure threads do not start until the boundary data is updated. We need to make sure that we don't start reading that data until it's ready. We need to produce a global sum of all the number of cars that move. Each thread can see how many cars it moved, but we need to produce a global number. And very importantly, to ensure that all threads are finished before the next iteration. And that's the critical synchronization here. that the threads are all operating independently, and if you don't put some synchronization, it's possible that one thread would get ahead of the other ones, and so we'll get the wrong answer. So if we just do it, talking about the shared variables model, we have really two concepts. One is that variables can be shared or private. The other one is that a region can be operated in serial or in parallel. But if you remember the model I had last time, that that we had a parent process and it had child threads, I'm thinking here of the serial thing just being done by a single process and the parallel one being done by these child threads. So when you do initialization, we'll just do that in serial, especially if we're calling random numbers. Parallel random numbers are a bit of a headache. So we can initialize in serial. That's just saying, look, there's a whole bunch of us in the office. There's four of us. We've got this big blackboard, but we'll just nominate one person to initialize the array. Okay, we won't bother parallelizing that. The loop over iterations is serial. It's just a counting loop. And then we have to do this simple calculation of set old of 0 equals old of n. And we might as well do that serially. We'll nominate one thread just to touch up the boundary conditions. Then the most important point is we can parallelize the loop over I. And as I said, although threads are accessing old I minus 1 and I plus 1, and so two threads might be reading from the same value at the same time, because they're always updating new I, they're never writing to the same value. So that's parallel. And then the important point is we need a synchronization before we do what looks like a fairly innocuous step of doing the copy back, set old I equals new I for the next iteration. We need to do that because, although if I'm a particular thread, I know once I've finished my loop that I'm happy, all my new values are fine. So why can't I set old I equals new I? The problem is that someone else may be reading old I. If we're on the boundary between two threads, I might be trying to update, I might be doing iterations I equals 4, 6, and 4, 5, and 6. I might think, well, I know what new 4 is, I can update old 4. Well, I can't update old 4 because the thread down the way might be updating cell 3, which needs the old 4. So it's not completely obvious, but you need to synchronize before you do that copy back step. You need to make sure you don't overwrite old till everyone has finished reading it. Then you need another synchronization, because before you do the boundary conditions, you need to check that old of I has been initialized everywhere. So you actually need two synchronizations in this loop, which is not immediately obvious, but turns out to be true of a large class of sort of scientific and technical operations, where you need one synchronization to make sure that you have finished what you're doing, and another synchronization to make sure that other people have finished what they're doing. It's slightly subtle. So that's where we parallelize it, and we need to also classify the variables as shared or private. Well, clearly old and new are shared. They're these big arrays which are living in on our shared blackboard, and can be shared, n is a constant, but we need to have a private variable I, because we're all looping over I independently. Well, one thread is updating I equals 1, 2, 3, another one might be updating I equals 4, 5, 6. So this is the look at the scratch space. Your loop for index I needs to be private. And again, that's quite typical. Loop counters tend to almost need to be private in this model. I haven't actually indicated it here, but we said there was another class of operation called a reduction operation. And so when we compute the total number of moves, we need to do that with a reduction operation, where we each compute our own number of moves and then globally reduce it, globally add it to produce this number. So that's the sketch of how the shared variables parallelism works. And if you look at the code, it very much follows that pattern. The message passing strategy, well, there's a number of message passing strategies you can use. The problem in message passing is that all the processes don't immediately have access to all the data. There is no shared memory. There is no shared blackboard. We all have our own blackboards. And so one strategy is where you say you nominate a process to read in the data, and then you broadcast it. You say, well, okay, we've got this long road, and we're going to divide up the calculation, but we're going to make sure everybody knows all the data. So we broadcast the data to two processes. So both processes, we have a complete copy of the entire road on these two blackboards. And then independently, a process can choose to update only its part of the road. So it might choose to update the left-hand side or the right-hand side. And it can do that because we have global information. But the problem then is we need to resynchronize. We now, each process only has a road where some part of it is up to date and some part of it isn't up to date. And we need to resynchronize all the data. After every time we update a section of the road, we need to do a global resynchronization. This is called a replicated data strategy, where every process knows all the data. And the problem is, and every process stores the interstate of the calculation. The problem with this, there are a lot of problems with this kind of parallelization strategy. It's very simple because everybody always knows all the data. But the two major problems are, A, it doesn't scale in terms of performance because this global resynchronization, we have to globally resynchronize all data after each move, and that is an enormous amount of message passing, enormous amount of load on our network. Secondly, it doesn't scale in terms of memory. We need to be able to fit the entire problem into the memory of every process. And for example, on something like Archer, that would be like saying, well, I have 120,000 cores, they each have 3 gigabytes, they have almost 400,000 gigabytes of data, but I'm not allowed to run, there's potentially 400,000 gigabytes of storage on Archer. You're saying, I cannot run a problem which is bigger than can be stored on a single process. You have 400,000 gigabytes and you're saying I can't run a problem bigger than 3 gigabytes. It's kind of crazy. And so as we saw yet last week, the way that message passing problems are really parallelized is through splitting the data up, domain decomposition. And so what we do, the real parallelization strategy you'd do is you split the data up and you wouldn't broadcast the data to all processes, you'd scatter it. And so that means that one process gets one half of the data and another process gets another half of the data. And we saw that was called a scatter operation. And the important point here is that the internal cells can be updated independently, but at the boundaries we need to communicate with our neighbor. I can't update the cell on the very right-hand side of my blue, dark blue section because I don't know what the value of the next cell is. And so what we do is we do this boundary swapping, halo swapping, which I talked about last week. And so what happens is, and so, okay, we split the calculation between two processes. Each, just like the previous strategy, each process is only responsible for a subset of the calculation. But they, in this strategy, they also only know the data for that subset of the calculation. And what we do is we gather the data we need. And in this approach, what we do is we need to gather the values of the cells to the left and the right of the domain we're responsible for, which we allows us to update the update our own road. So the way it works, again, this is just in text what I've just said before. The important point is that you can update your interior cells. If you're a road of length n on p processes, each process is responsible for a road of length n over p. You can update the n over p minus 2 interior cells because you have all the information, but at the edge, you can't update the edge cells because that requires information from the process to the left and the right of you. And so what you have to do is we want to go from that state to that state here. I'm just illustrating a simple example. So what we do is we have two processes. We add this halo data. In the serial code, I was able to update these halos just by copying. In the parallel code, that requires message passing. So you have to send messages so that the data is transferred from the boundary values of your calculation into the halo values of your neighbor. And once we've done this, you can then update the road locally. So this is typical of real parallel calculations. You have two phases. You have a communication phase where you gather all the data you need, and then you do a calculation phase independently of your neighbors. Then you go back into communication phase. So typically there's a kind of a differentiate communication and calculation phases. Well, we now know, we update the interior cell. So I know that on the left-hand side, thread one, process one maybe had n move equals 1, and process 2 had n move equals 2, and again we need to do one of these reduction operations which are conceptually the same in both the distributed memory and shared memory models. We bring them together to get 3 moves. And if you look at the code, hopefully that makes, the way I've written the code, hopefully it's reasonably self-explanatory, even if you don't understand. So I've implemented it using MPI, but I've tried to hide the MPI through a sort of a small communications layer which makes it sort of obvious what's going on. And very briefly, just to recap, if you did the fractals exercise, I'll skip through this quite quickly, but I really wanted to show that one of the key things I think I want to get across in all the, we're going to stop talking about parallelism now, but in all the parallelization stuff, is that you need to quantify things. You need to quantify your performance. You need to quantify your scalability. And even in this fractals exercise, where the issue is load balance, we can make quantitative statements. And so this was all on the exercise sheet, but I won't go through it. What I wanted to show was the example results. So what I did here, the issue was that the calculation is load imbalanced, so that the dark areas take a lot longer, thousands of times longer to compute than the light areas. So for example, if I ran a task farm here on 5 processes with one master and 4 workers, Here, worker one would have a lot of work to do, and worker two would have a lot of work to do, and the other people would be might be largely idle. And as we reduce the granularity, so the key point in the tasks farm is you have more tasks than you have processes, more tasks than you have CPUs, and you dynamically allocate the tasks to processes to balance the load. And so as we increase the number of tasks, the load balance improves and our performance should improve. So if I pick a fixed number of workers, say 17 processes, which is one controller, 16 workers, if I run with 16 tasks, that means that each worker only gets one task. If I have 192 by 192 tasks, and it's a 768 by 768 problem, I have 16 tasks, one worker each has one task. That took just about 2 seconds, 1.93 seconds. But what you can also compute is this load imbalance factor, which is the ratio of the maximum load to the average load. So that's saying that in that calculation, the maximally loaded processor had five times as much work to do as the average. And that's clearly not a good thing. If you balance the load, everybody will have the average. The other way of thinking about it is this tells you that this calculation ought to be able to go five times faster. It took almost 2 seconds, but because the load imbalance was five, you ought to be able to do it in about 0.4 seconds. And as we increase the number of tasks, make the tasks smaller and therefore increase the number of tasks, the load imbalance approaches one, as you see on the right-hand side. So the maximum loaded process has about the average, which is the ideal situation. So you'd expect the time to decrease, but it doesn't always decrease, because when you have too many tasks, the cost, the overhead of distributing and gathering the tasks back again starts to outweigh this load balance, the benefits of load balance. And so if you have tasks of one pixel wide, you have as many, you make them the smallest task you can, then the time starts to go up again. And the easiest thing to do is to plot a graph where basically we have the, from the execution time on 16 tasks, we can predict what we think the execution time would be on any number of tasks, given the load imbalance factor. And we see that what happens is that the actual time, which is the blue, approaches the predicted time, which is the theoretical best time we could get, until we start to get tasks which are too small, and then the time goes up again. So what that is just telling you is that as you make the tasks smaller, you're able to overcome this problem that the calculation is load imbalanced. Everyone starts to get the same amount of work to do, but if you make tasks too small, then the overhead of doing that starts to dominate. So there's always some trade-off. In fact, the turnoff here is quite high because Archer has a very fast network. This was on an Archer. On another system, the turnover might be a much smaller number of tasks because the overhead of communicating and distributing the tasks and collecting them back in would be relatively higher on a non-dedicated supercomputer. So those were really just going over those two key examples from last week. And now, hopefully, in the next 40 minutes before 3 o'clock, I can go on to the next lecture, which is sort of taking a sidestep, not talking about parallelization at all, but talking about the sort of the basics of numerical computing. And it's this one here. Yep. So how computers store real numbers and the problems that result. So one of the defining features of scientific and technical calculation, scientific computing, is you're trying to solve problems in the real world. And most real problems cannot be described in integers. If you're talking about rainfall, weather speed, speed of a car, these things are all real numbers. So it's very important to understand how they're stored on a computer. So this is just to recap the kind of scientific process. You have some mathematical equations, provide a description of the model. You have some experiment. And we now bring in this computer simulation for problems which are too big, small, difficult, or dangerous for standard methods. And I had this slide right in the first talk. So typically what we do is that we observe something in nature, you do some experiment, you have some mathematics which gives you a model, and what you'd like to do is to do an exact solution of that model to give you a prediction and see if you observe what your prediction is. In practice, you can very rarely solve these things exactly, so you use approximate solution, either simplified or numerical. So typically, what you tend to do if you want to solve these any physical problem on pencil and paper, without using a computer, is you have to make the equation simpler and simpler and simpler so you can solve them. So you typically end up with an exact solution, but of a simplified model. With numerical methods, you can typically set solve a problem which is closer to the real model, but then you have the issues that you've got a numerical solution, not an analytic solution, and then what are the issues to do with that? And so we start off with the real world, we have some mathematical model, we then have a numerical algorithm which we write down, so we're going to solve this in this way, we then implement that on a computer, and then we put in some input and we come with some output. So for example, we observe the weather, we represent a series of equations, we then work out how we're going to solve those equations on a computer, we then write a program to do that, and then we feed in what the weather is today and we get out what the weather is tomorrow. But all these stages have errors, and it's essential to understand these errors. So in this context, errors doesn't mean mistakes. Errors means approximations, things which aren't quite exact. But they're not errors in the sense, most of them aren't errors in the sense of mistakes. But they do mean you don't quite get exactly the right answer. And so one of the most important questions you have to ask when you're doing any numerical calculation is the solution obtained good enough? Have I done my calculation accurately enough so that my solution to the problem is actually meaningful? And where you get errors are, when you go from the real world to the mathematical model, you might make some approximations. So if you were simulating how a car is driven around an air track, you might say, well, I'll just ignore air resistance. That's too hard. I'll just ignore air resistance. Pretend that we're in a vacuum or something like that. That'll make the problem simpler. Then when you go from the mathematical model to the numerical algorithm on paper, you have things called truncation errors, and we'll talk about those today. When you represent any equation on a computer, you typically get these things called truncation errors, and they're very important to understand. When you go from your numerical algorithm on paper to your actual implementation in code, you get rounding errors. And this is what we're going to talk about first, the fact that a real number isn't stored exactly on a computer. It's stored to some finite precision. And that can lead to issues. The final one, which is often ignored, are data errors. If you put the wrong data in, you get the wrong answer out. Well, again, one of the problems about predicting the weather tomorrow is you don't know what the weather is today, because you may only have observation stations every 10 kilometers or something. That's one of the major challenges with predicting what the weather is tomorrow. The biggest problem is actually knowing what the weather is today, because you don't have complete information. Or you can just make errors. You could just genuinely have some error in your input data, some glitch or something like that. Even when you have a very, very sophisticated and way of solving some set of equations or some model, you're limited by the accuracy of your measurements from the real world. So this is basically, poor data. It's very difficult to write a code that will compensate for errors in your input data. I mean, you can do checks. If the input data says the wind is more than 200 miles an hour, you might question that if you're living in the UK. Actually, badly stored data is one of the most common problems. You read in the data, and then you write it out, and you maybe write it out as text on the screen, you're going to possibly lose some precision there. So that is a big issue that people have. You might do the calculation very accurately, and then you write out 3.7 as the answer. So writing data as text, although it's nicer, we can read it, may not be ideal. If you want to dump the state of a simulation from the computer's memory onto disk exactly, to be able to restart it without any differences, you're probably going to have to dump the raw data as binary, and we'll talk about that later. Writing things as text can be an issue. Truncation errors are, again, we'll address that, the actual problem I'm setting today, or example code I'm giving you illustrates truncation errors. It's due to the difference between the mathematical model and the numerical algorithm. So it doesn't depend on the implementation or the precision. So for example, how do you compute the sine x? Well, what you do is actually, sine x, don't know how to compute it. Well, there's a series expansion. X minus x cubed over 3 factorial, x to the fifth over 5 factorial is an expansion. And if you take this expansion to infinity, you get exactly the right answer. Unfortunately, we can't take the expansion to infinity. We have to stop. So that's why there's all truncation errors. We truncate the series at some finite order. So basically, in reality, you cannot expand these series infinitely. You truncate at some finite order. And it may not be obvious, but the way that the equivalent thing in a real simulation comes from discretizing the problem. A weather simulation may take place on a 10-kilometer grid. We have a simulation and we have data points which we evolve on some finite grid. And it's that discretization of the grid, the fact we have a foot. In reality, there is no grid, okay? In reality, the world is a continuum. In our computer simulation, we can only store a finite number of numbers and we tend to impose some grid. And this induces these truncation errors. And so you can control truncation errors by using a smaller grid, but this requires a lot more computer time. That's one of the challenges. You know, you're trying to make these truncation discretization errors as small as possible by having a very fine grid, but the finer the grid you have, you know. So if I went from a 10-kilometer grid to a 1-kilometer grid, that would be 100 times as much work because I have 100 times as many points. So that's one of the issues. So truncation errors are really very key. Rounding errors are due to the fact that real values are stored approximately on any computer. And that's what I'm going to cover for the rest of this talk. Because it is very important to when you do any numerical calculation using floating point numbers, it's very important to understand this. And so naively, I'm going to very quickly talk about integers, then reals, floats, doubles, and such like, and a bit about arithmetic operations. But we often write things like our x equals square root of 2, okay? That seems like a very innocuous statement. But how is this actually stored? And you can see there are going to be issues, or that there are issues, if I just run a very simple code. This is on the web. I have a little program, which all it does is it has float, we'll see these are single precision values, x single and x single squared, and doubles x double and x double squared. I set x to be the square root of 2, and I square it up. So hopefully, the nice thing about taking the square root is, I don't know how to take a square root, but if you tell me something is square root of 2, I can check if it is. I square it up and see if I get 2, okay? So if you say this is the square root of a number, I can check quite easily by squaring it up. So what I'm doing is computing the square root of 2 and squaring it again. Hopefully I get back 2 again. And so all I'm printing out is what the actual values are, what the values squared are. Then I'm going to print to some higher precision. Then I'm going to print how different these are from 2. So I'm going to print the values. I'm going to print the square. I'm going to print the square to some high precision. I'm going to print the difference from 2. And I'm going to do that twice. And I'll do that for both single and double precision. So it's maybe just easy if I run this. CC minus O, C square root. I'm losing the bottom of this screen, which is why I'm not doing too sensibly. Minus O, C square root dot C. And then I run it. And you see a number of issues. First of all, to the order I printed out, the answers seem to be the same in single position and double position. Okay, so that looks okay. And I square them up and I get 2, and that looks fine. The problem is when I print floating point numbers, at least in C, it has some default way of printing them. And the default here is to print about 6 or 7 significant figures. So if I print them out to a higher precision, you can see that in fact the single precision number squared isn't 2, it gets 1.99998. And even the double precision number squared isn't 2, it's 2 point lots of zeros, but eventually you see it isn't exactly 2. So we could, rather than printing the number squared and seeing whether it's 2, it's easier to subtract 2 from it. So if I subtract 2 from it and print it out in the default manner, I get 0, I get minus 0. But again, that's one of the issues with C, at least when you print floating point numbers out, it isn't particularly clever as to how many significant figures or the precision it prints them out to. So if I don't use F, which is floating point number, but I use G, which says use scientific notation, percent G in C, I get something more useful. I'll see that if I use single precision, the error in X squared is about 1 part in 10 to the 7, because the X squared minus 2 is 1.19, well, minus 1 times 10 to the minus 7. And the error in the double precision value is about 1 part in 10 to the 16. So what we'll try and cover really in this talk is why is the error in the single precision value of order 10, 1 part in 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8, and the error in the double precision value is 1 part in 10 to the 16. So those are useful numbers. You can just write a 3-line program to work that out. But what we'll try and do is try and cover why that's true. If I can find my... Well, do integers first. Well, so math is an ideal world. If you're a mathematician, integers can be infinitely large as you want. Real numbers can be large or small as you want. You can represent everything exactly. Root 2, pi, 10 to the minus this big number, 10 to a big number. So mathematically, numbers can range from minus infinity to plus infinity. And in any interval, you have an infinite number. So you can have infinite precision, okay? And that's not true on a computer. On a computer, we have limited range, both for integers and real numbers, and limited precision for real numbers. And where do those limitations come from? So we like to use base 10. Base 10 is a horrible base to use, but unfortunately, we have 10 fingers. If we had 12 fingers or 8 fingers, I think 12 would be a wonderful number. 12 is a much number, nice number. Divisible by 3. All natural bases have 12. 12 hours, you know, 12, you know, 24 hours in a day is 2 12s. 12 inches in a foot, if you're from a British imperial background. Most natural systems that arrive have 12 as a base. They're much more natural, but unfortunately we have 10 fingers. So what we do is we use position to represent each power of 10. So if I write 125, what does 125 mean? It means 1 times 10 squared, because the 1 is in position 2, 2 times 10 to the 1, because the 2 is in position 1, and 5 times 10 to the 0, because the 5 is in position 0. That's 1 times 100 plus 2 times 10 plus 5 times 1, which is 125. That's what 125 means. So we represent the power of 10 by the position. And then we put a plus or minus at the start. So of course we know computers are binary machines. They can only store ones and zeros. So the natural thing for computers is to use base 2. And typically the minimum storage quantum we have is a byte, which is 8 bits. So in base 2, if we wanted to do 225, it would be 111101, which is just 1 times 2 to the 6, plus 1 times 2 to the 5, plus 1 times 2 to the 4, plus, plus, plus. It's exactly the same as power of 10, it's just that we use powers of 2. And that gives us the same number. So, okay, base 10, base 2. Integers is not really a big deal whether you use base 10 or base 2. The only issue you have is the range. So if we only use 8 bits for integers, the maximum value is 0, and the minimum value is 0, and the maximum value is 2 to the 8 minus 1 is 255. And the problem with integers, if you get too big, you overflow and you get the wrong answer. Well, actually, most computers in C and Fortran, if you declare an integer, most computers will give you 4 bytes. So most languages define integers default to be 4 bytes. The minimum value is 0, and the maximum value is 2 to the 32 minus 1, which is about 4 billion. So the question is this a problem? Well, it didn't used to be a problem, because when computers were invented, people thought, you know, why would, if you want to, it's a problem in the sense that if you want to address memory, you need to have memory addresses, and if you store memory addresses in an integer, you can't address more than 4 gigabytes of memory. So this didn't seem like a problem back in the 70s, when you probably had about 5 kilobytes of data. But people get very confused about this thing. What is a 32-bit operating system? People think, or a 64-bit operating system, people think, oh, in a 64-bit operating system, integers will have 8 bytes. No, that's not true. The 32-bit, 64-bit operating system just says, when you store a memory address, a pointer if you're a C programmer, do you store it in 4 bytes or 8 bytes? That's all it's saying, okay? And unfortunately, when computers were invented, everyone thought, oh, let's store memory addresses in 4 bytes. You know, nobody will ever have a machine with more than 4 gig of memory. And then recently we started to get machines with more 4 gig of memory. So all modern operating systems are 64-bit operating systems, which simply means that they use 8 bytes of storage to store memory addresses, pointers. So you can use 8 bytes, 64-bit integers, and they'll have a much bigger range, 4 gig squared, whatever that is. But that is important. Some people think I'm on a 64-bit operating system. That means that my integers will be 64 bits. That is not true. Even on a 64-bit operating system, if you do int x, integer x, you will get a 4-byte integer. So negative numbers, just to recap, and I've done this, but we use this 2's complement representation. It seems a strange thing to do, but you flip all the ones to zeros and then you add one. So negative integers have the first bit set to 1. So for 8 bits, the range isn't 0 to 255, it's minus 1 to 8 to 127. And 2's complement is just a bit of a trick. So 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1 is 3 in binary. We then flip the bits, so we get all ones and zeros, and then we add 1. And that's how we represent minus 3. So minus 3 is all the 1, 0, 1. And the reason that's useful is if you add and numbers in 2's complement representation, then it all works out. If you ignore the, so if I add 125 plus minus 3, and I ignore the overflow on the left, I get 122. So it's just a trick. It allows you to do subtraction in the same way as you do addition. To add a negative number, you take its 2's complement, flip all the bits and add 1. You can then add them as if they were positive, and the way it all works out, you get the right answer. And you have to ignore the fact that you get an overflow on the left. But you just ignore that. So integers, computers that really like integers, you can add, subtract, and multiply with a complete accuracy, well, as long as they're not too large in magnitude. But as long as you have enough storage to store the answer, then you don't have any problems. But the problem is, what about division? Well, 4 over 2 is 2, that's fine. 27 over 3 is 9, but what about 7 over 3? If we do 7 over 3, and if we do int I is 7, int j equals 3, int k equals I over j, we'll get 2. So how are we going to store real numbers? So the first thing you could do is you might say, well, it's kind of obvious. We'll use fixed point. So what we'll say is, we've got 8 bits, so we can store a number x between 0 and 255. We'll just divide that by 256. So if I have an 8-bit number, which can be between 0 and 255, and I'll say, well, actually, that represents x over 256. Okay. So if I want to do 5 over 9, which is 0.55555, I represent that as x is 142. Because in my, it's called fixed point. We'll come back to why it's called fixed point arithmetic before. I store x equals 142, but that actually represents 142 over 256. And so if we want to do multiplication, it's quite easy. We just say that if you operation now treat integers as fractions. So c equals a times b is the same thing as z equals x times y over 256. If we want to multiply 2, so again, we're just dividing by a fixed number. It's called fixed point arithmetic. We store a number between 0 and 255. We divide that number by 256, which allows us to store a number between 0 and just about 1. And then we can just use the integer units to do multiplication. And this was how people did things in the early days. They still used integer units on early processors, but interpreted the results as real numbers. So between the upper and lower limits, 0 and 1, we have a uniform grid of possible numbers. We can only store 256 different real numbers in this range, and our accuracy is one part in 256. We split up into a grid. So clearly, you could take 4-byte numbers, which go between 0 and 4 billion, and divide that by 4 billion. It looks like a quite accurate way of representing real numbers. The problem comes, so this is very fast, but it doesn't cope with large ranges. So the way that we defined our numbers there, we cannot represent numbers less than 0 or numbers bigger than 1. So we can adjust the range. We can say, well, actually, we'll not divide by 256, we'll divide by 26. So we can represent numbers between 0 and 10. The problem there is we've lost precision. You know, we have a bigger range, but the gap between them is bigger. So these are the problems with fixed point numbers. That they can, if you know what the range of all your numbers, if you know all your numbers in your calculation are going between 0 and 1, then you're probably okay with fixed point arithmetic. But that's not true in reality. You don't know what the numbers are going to be. And so, why it's called fixed point arithmetic is, imagine we had decimal numbers. So imagine we've only got enough storage for 5 decimal numbers. Okay, it's like saying we chose an 8-bit storage for integer. In decimal, we've only got 5 spaces we can use. So if we wanted to represent 0.42617, we'd say, well, the decimal point is at the start there. So we fix the point at the start. So the number 42617, it represents 0.42617. That's like dividing it by 100,000. Or we could say, no, we want numbers up to 100, so we'll put the decimal point there. So 42617 represents 42.617. Or we could say, we want to represent really big numbers, so the point is over on the right. So if the number is 42617, it actually represents 4,261,700. Or a really small numbers, we could shift the decimal point way off to the left. So that's the analogy. It's like saying we have a fixed number of storage locations, 8 bits, or here five decimal numbers, and we're saying the decimal point is fixed. Okay, So 42617 represents 42.617 because the decimal point is fixed in the middle. We've fixed our divisor as being 100, which fixes the position of the decimal point. The problem there is, if we have numbers like 42617, 4 million and 0.0426, we can't store them in the same storage scheme. If we've chosen to put the decimal point very far to the left, then a number's bigger than, you know, 0.01, we can't store. If we've chosen to put the decimal point very far to the right, then we can't store small numbers. So what we really want is a self-adjusting scheme where the decimal point moves to where it needs to be. And that's why they're called floating point numbers, that rather than having a storage scheme where the decimal point is fixed, the decimal point is allowed to move. So previously the decimal point was fixed. Why don't we shift the decimal place so it's now at the start? So what we'll say is, if we have a number 42617, that always represents 0.42617. But we store it as 0.42617. We remember what that actually represents by how many decimal spaces we had to shift the decimal point. So for example, to store 4261700, we would store 0.42617, but remember that the real number has the decimal point shifted seven places to the right. Or to store 0.042617, we'd still store 0.42617, but remember the exponent was -1, saying we need to shift the decimal point, one place to the left. So in fact, floating point numbers in a computer are just a computer way of scientific notation. In scientific notation, we don't write 4261700, we write 0.4262 times 10 to the 7, or 0.04267 would be 0.4262 times 10 to the minus 1. So the actual number is 0.mmmmm times 10 to the e. M means Mantissa and e is exponent. So you separate out the sort of the big scale of the number, is it a 10, 100, 1,000, from what the actual, from the fine grain. So we always use all five numbers. We don't waste space. And it automatically adjusts the magnitude of the number being stored. Okay, so what we're saying is, we've only got five spaces to use. What we will do is we'll split them. We'll use four spaces for the mantissa and one space for the exponent. And the decimal point floats left and right as required. And the outcome is that fixed point numbers have a constant absolute error, which might be one part in 0.00001, one part in 100,000. Floating point numbers tend to have a constant relative error of order. Here it would be 0.01%. So computer storage of real numbers are directly analogous to scientific notation. You represent the mantissa, which is what you normally think of the number, and its magnitude, how big it is in the exponent, which is the same thing as saying you let the decimal point float left and right. And you might think this seems like a complicated scheme, but in fact, the amazing thing is that modern processors can deal with floating point numbers directly in hardware. People have agreed on what the format of floating point numbers is, and there will be a single instruction on a modern processor to multiply two double precision real numbers together to give you a result, a single machine code instruction, which is, I always find, quite amazing. That is why I think it's important to understand floating point numbers and their storage. In that they're all stored the same. Modern processors, they're all stored the same way, and the floating point multiplication is implemented in hardware. So you could choose a different format. You could say, I don't want to use IEEE 754 as the standard. I want to use my own format. But you'd have to implement all your numerical operations in software, and they would be thousands of times slower. So the standard which defines how floating point numbers are stored is called IEEE 754. So it really is just the same as saying, I'll go back, we've got five in decimal, we've got five places we can store numbers. We'll use four of them for the number and one for the exponent. All IEEE 754 says, well, how much of a floating point number is devoted to each of these parts. So in IEEE 754, you have a sign, so we remember whether the number is plus or minus with a leading sign. just like we did in with integers, naught is positive and one is negative. We then reserve a certain number of bits for the exponent and the rest of the mantissa. And there's just a slight subtlety that we don't use 2's complement. We need to be able to steal positive and negative exponents. A number could be 0.4 times 10 to the 3 or 0.4 times 10 to the minus 5. That exponent could be positive or negative. But for technical reasons, we don't store the exponent in 2's complement. We just shift it. So an exponent of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is shifted to actually represent an exponent of minus 3 up to 4. So there's some bias, which is how you get from the exponent stored to the actual exponent. There are some reasons for that. But all this format says is how much is what's the division between the exponent and the mantissa. So, well, actually, you'll have seen in our choice for byte, for decimal, all our numbers start 0 point something or other. So there's no need to store them zero. We've normalized the mantissa always between always to be between 0 and 1. So it always starts with 0. So you'd be mad to dedicate one of your storage spaces to that 0 when it's always 0. Okay? The equivalent in IEEE representation is that the floating point mantissa is normalized between 1 and 2. Now in binary, that's 1.0 to 1 0 point. So now binary fractions look really weird, I have to say. But I'll try and explain how they work. But the mantissa is always normalized to lie in the binary range 1 and 2. So the leading point, the leading bit of the mantissa is always 1. So storage is precious. We've only got 32 or 64 bits. We don't want to waste one. So because the leading bit is always 1, we don't store it. And this is given the slightly cryptic name of the hidden bit. So if you store our mantissa as f, then the real mantissa is 1.f. This does mean, if you think about it, 0 needs a special treatment. How can you store 0 when the mantissa is always 1? Well, if you have f and d all as zeros, that's defined to be 0. So 0 is a special format. And that's quite nice, actually, that 0 in floating point storage is the same as integer 0. It's all zeros. So just to say, binary fractions look a bit weird, but whole numbers, it's straightforward. Base 10, 109 means that. In base 2, we've seen that that's 109. In fractions, 109.625, we just keep going. 109 is 1 times 10 squared plus 0 times 10 to the 1 plus 9 times 10 to the 0. And then we just keep going. It's 6 times 10 to the minus 1 plus 2 times 10 to the minus 2 plus 5 times 10 to the minus 3. So, you know, numbers to the right of the decimal point are tenths, hundredths, thousandths. In binary, numbers to the right of the decimal point are halves, quarters, and eighths. So 110101.101 is the same number, 109.625. I've conveniently chosen a number which is exactly representable. But they do look a bit weird, these writing binary fractions, but if you don't think too hard and just follow the formula, you can see that they do make sense. So again, you can think of binary fractions a slightly different way. That's just a different, that's just another way of thinking about it. So this is really the most important slide. This standard IEEE 754 defines that. If you define a single precision floating point number, which in C is real, in C it's float, or in Fortran is real, you will get one sign bit, 8 exponent bits, and 24 mantissa. Well, remember we've got this hidden bit, so we store 23. It's always actually 24. So the actual number is minus 1 to the s, that's the sign, times 1.f, that's your binary fraction, times 2 to the c minus 127. The exponent, which can go between 0 and 255, is shifted, so it would be positive and negative. But probably the most important numbers to remember are, it's single precision, we have about 8 significant figures in the about 8 significant figures in the mantissa, and the range is between plus 10 to the plus or minus 38. So what that's saying is, if you print out a single precision number, only the first 8 values are significant, mean anything. And you cannot store a number smaller than 10 to the minus 38 or bigger than 10 to the plus 38. Okay. Double precision extends that range. You have twice as much accuracy, twice as many significant figures, and a much bigger range. So double precision numbers can store, have about 16 significant figures of accuracy and about 10 to the and a range between 10 to the plus or minus 308, which is a very big range. So if we go back to my example, that's why you can see here that this, I would have said we had a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I'm saying that, you know, numbers after about here start, so that's saying you expect this to go wrong in about the eighth significant figure, about the seventh decimal place. And that's kind of what we get. In double precision, you expect it to be about 16, so that's 1, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Again, you'd expect it to start going wrong round about the 16th or 17th, and that's what happens. So it's important to note that single precision numbers are only really meaningful or accurate in about their first eight significant figures. This is just noise. And double precision numbers are only accurate or meaningful in about their first 16 significant figures. This is just noise. Okay. So those really, you know, eight significant, 16 significant figures are quite important numbers to try and have in your head when you're doing numerical calculations. And the range is between 10 to the plus or minus 38 or 10 to the plus or minus 308 in single and double. There are some extended types, but they're not uniformly supported. Single and double are absolutely universally supported. So that's in C, float and double, in Fortran, real and double precision. I think most other languages probably use float and double. So, again, I've said here, conventionally, they're called single and double precision. C, C plus Java floats 32-bit, double 64-bit. Fortran has a slightly more sophisticated type system, but the default ones, real and double, are 32 and 64. I keep saying this has nothing to do with 32-bit, 64-bit operating systems. I've heard people say, oh, I've got a 64-bit operating system. That means that my real numbers are 64 bits. No, it doesn't. A 64-bit operating system means that memory addresses are stored in 64-bit integers. It's got nothing to do with the precision of your floating point numbers, nothing to do with the precision of your integers, it's memory addresses. So I've talked about this. Fortran is quite good. Fortran being a scientific language, when you print out numbers, it prints them out to some sensible range. It will tend to print out single precision numbers to about six or seven significant figures and double precision numbers to the right. C and Java aren't so good at that. It does depend a bit on the compiler, but as we saw, when we printed out a single and double precision number in C, there was no indication that they had different precisions. They were printed out to the same accuracy. The main limitation is, you said that you can store a number, say in single precision, between 10 to the minus 38 and 10 to the plus 38. That doesn't mean that you can do calculations that accurately. The problem is that you get problems when numbers have very different magnitudes. So we can store 10 to the minus 6 exactly. We can store 10 to the plus 6 exactly, okay? But if we add them together, 0.001 plus a million, we get a million point five zeros and a one. And we don't have enough accuracy to store that in 32-bit arithmetic. So although we can store 10 to the minus 6 exactly, and we can store 10 to the plus 6 exactly, if we add them together, it gets truncated, potentially. So in 32-bit arithmetic, if you add 10 to the minus 6 and 10 to the plus 6, you get 10 to the plus 6. And these are what we typically call rounding errors. And one of the major problems with these is that they don't, that means that on a computer, floating point arithmetic is not associative. The order you do things matters. So if I do the first calculation, 10 to the minus 6 plus 10 to the 6, I do that first, that gets rounded to 10 to the 6. I take off 10 to the 6, I get 0. But if I do it in a different order, if I add the two numbers on the right first, well, a million minus a million is 0. Then I add that to 10 to the minus 6, and I get 10 to the minus 6. So this fact that you can only store limited precision in the mantissa means that floating point arithmetic is commutative. A plus B is always the same as B plus A, but not associative. A plus B plus C is not the same thing as A plus B plus C. So that means you get slightly different answers depending on how you write your code. Now, so that is a problem. potentially. Again, this is just another example of the same issue. So again, this is just a piece of code which did that previous thing and wrote it out, and we got in single, again, we've used 10 to the minus 10 here, and in single it cannot be resolved, so we get different answers, but in double we can resolve them, we get one. So this was just a code, if you look at the code, so I shouldn't go through that so quickly. We're doing A plus B plus C or A plus B plus C. X is add the first two numbers together and then the third. Y is add the last two numbers together and the first one. And you'll see that X, we get this cancellation between A and B, so we're always going to get 1. But if we try and add 10 to the minus 10 to 1, it's going to get rounded away. So we expect that Y will be wrong and X will be correct. And you can see that in single precision, you can't resolve the second calculation, but in double precision you can. But if we went to some bigger numbers like 10 to the minus 20, we would get 1 in both cases. So I don't have really time to go through this, but basically there's lots of special numbers. If you run floating point calculations and you get things wrong, you'll sometimes get things, you'll say the answer is inf, which means the answer is infinity, or the answer is not a number, which might print out NaN. And these have special bit patterns. And you get these things, for example, technically infinity is when you divide by any finite number divided by zero is infinity. However, it's nice to remember that was infinity, because then you can get because if you then do minus 3 over infinity, you get 0. So infinity says you've got an overflow, but you may get, well, in certain situations, you should always worry when you get that. But there are special bit patterns used to sort these numbers. Not a number is when you've got not a number. The obvious one is square root of a negative number. So once you get a not a number in your any calculation involving not a number returns not a number. So if you square root of a negative number is the classic thing, and if your program prints out, you know, the answer equals not a number, it's a good sign that you've done something stupid like divide zero by zero or infinity by infinity or take square root of a negative number. So I won't go through the special values here. So in implementations, the final slide really is to note that most C and Fortran compilers are fully IEEE 754 compliant. So in principle, the standard doesn't just define the storage for any floating point numbers, it uniquely defines the result of any computation. So, you know, A times B should be the same on any computer if A and B are the same numbers, because IEEE 754 defines that the floating point numbers should be stored the same way. And you can sometimes switch on exception handlers. You can say, look, if you get a problem, if you get an overflow, an underflow, something, please stop. There are some subtle differences, though. For example, Fortran, being a numerical language, has strict rules. A plus B plus C is guaranteed to be implemented as A plus B plus C. But C compilers can do different things. So two different compilers can give you different answers in C, because A plus B plus C could be implemented as add the first two, then the third, or add the first, then the next two. We've seen that can give you different answers. So we saw extreme values here where we had completely different answers. But in reality, you would get subtle differences possibly in the last bit. So typically, if you switch off all optimization, if you tell the compiler, I don't want you to do any optimization, compilers just work left to right. You know, they do the obvious thing. But the more you turn on compiler optimization, the more the compiler will try and play tricks and do things in different orders. And so that's a classic sign of a program having issues with limited precision, is that it gets different answers based on whether you do, for example, minus O0 in GCC, which is no optimization, up to minus O3. At minus O3, it might say, well, I'll try and be clever. Maybe I previously computed B plus C. Okay, so I've got that. So I won't, if I want to compute A plus B plus C, I'd be stupid to add A and B together than C, because I already know B plus C, so I'll compute it the other way. So you can get these subtle differences. So that's really the end. Real numbers are stored in floating point format. On all modern systems, it conforms to this IEEE 754 standard. IEEE 754 defines the storage format, and the classic ones are single and double precision. And it in principle defines the result of all these arithmetical operations. There's lots of issues to be aware of, though in practice, you have to be aware that just because a program gives slightly different answers each time, just because a program can give slightly different answers, doesn't really matter, okay? If I ran a numerical weather prediction that said tomorrow the wind speed is going to be 19.53 kilometers per hour, and I ran another computer and it said the wind speed is going to be 19.54 kilometers per hour, you know, nobody cares if the wind, you know, that's accurate enough. So it's very important to realize that, you know, you just get that we need to get the results accurate enough for your purposes. They don't have to be, there is no exact answer, but you need to define, and this is where it gets quite difficult, you need to define, you know, how accurate you need the results. There is no point in knowing, well, in most situations, there's no point in knowing the wind speed to more accurate than, you know, even a kilometer an hour for most people, possibly. Other things you might need to know really, really accurately if you're going to do some GPS calculation and trying to pinpoint your position to 1 centimeter across the whole world, you're probably going to have a much more accurate result. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a break till 3:30, and the next lecture is going to be trying to give some flavor of what kind of numerical algorithms are used in real scientific computing. And the classic test case, which everyone studies and it is a nice test case, is linear algebra, matrix equations. I've got a very, hopefully illustrates all the basic points, and I'll try and start from quite a basic level, but it illustrates the kind of ways that we translate mathematical problems into numerical calculations, and I'll try and indicate at what points you have to worry about these issues that you have to remember when I'm implementing this on a computer. I don't have mathematical accuracy, I don't have infinite range, I don't have infinite precision. But it's really a test bed, a well-constrained test bed. Linear algebra, I'll explain what it all means in the next slide, in the next talk. That'll be back at 3:30. Okay, so I'll just run through this example of linear algebra. As I said, it's basically a test bed for sort of numerical algorithms, and I'll try and explain where the issues we've talked about, the fact that floating point numbers going to be stored to finite precision, enter into calculations like this. So I'll talk about matrices and basic linear algebra. Hopefully I'll start from the bottom up so to get you introduced if you're not familiar with these terminology or you've not heard it for a while. So I'll cover why matrices and linear algebra are so important, some basic terminology. I'll cover something called Gauss-Jordan elimination, which is a standard algorithm, which actually you may recognize from when you solve linear equations at school. I don't remember that far back. Then I'll do LU factorization and talk a bit about error estimation and libraries. So in maths, linear algebra is the study of linear transformation of vector spaces. But in practice, that comes down to study of matrices and vectors. And it may not be obvious, hopefully I'll cover this next week, but many physical problems can be formulated in terms of matrices and vectors. So for example, if we take the sort of partial differential equations that describe how fluid flows or the weather works, they're differential equations, mathematical differential equations. If we put them onto a finite grid, as we have to do to solve them numerically, that leads to having to solve matrix equations. Now, I'll probably outline that next week, but the important point is that in a large class of scientific and technical problems, what you have to solve at the end of the day is a large matrix equation. So that turns out to be why these are such a been studied to such an extent. So this is just a bit, don't let the terminology scare you. This field's been around for a long time, and there's, in fact, the concepts are really quite straightforward. The algorithms are quite easy to understand. Implementing them can be surprisingly easy, although I'll say at the end you shouldn't really implement them yourself, so you should use a library. But every slight variation in an algorithm seems to have its own terminology, so the terminology can get a bit bloated, but I think the concepts are really quite straightforward and hopefully easy to understand. So just to remind you, a matrix is a 2x2 object, say A, a 3x3 matrix, and we'll deal almost exclusively with square matrices in this lecture. And the numbering scheme for matrices is such that A11 is in the top left-hand corner, and the first index goes down, A11, A21, A31, and then you go across. So that the counting is down and across, AI down, J across. And because matrices conventionally start numbering from 1, the first element is A11, that's the origin, the fact that Fortran matrices and vectors start from 1. The first element of a Fortran array is A1. Whereas in C, it would be A0. So that comes from the fact that it was originally designed to be a mathematical language. A vector is just a single vector, v, v1, v2, v3. So we have, the most important point is that what we need to understand, you multiply matrix by a vector, the way I think about it is the formula. The first element of the vector v1 is replaced by a11 v1 plus a12 v2 plus a13 v3. So what I think of this you can think of this as being a dot product. It's the dot product of this row of the matrix with the vector. Or I think of these. I have this mental model of these rows kind of coming along and sliding off. But you can think of it as the dot product. So V1 is replaced with the dot product of the first row with V. V2 is replaced with the dot product of the second row with V and V, and so on. And you might, this would be a way of representing a rotation, for example. Your vector might be some point in space, X, Y, Z. You might be doing some graphics application. And in that point, A might represent rotating the vector or rotating your view. But that's the general thing. Matrix times vector gives you a vector. And if you want to do matrix times matrix, it's exactly the same, except you treat each column of the matrix as if it were a vector. So you just sweep along in the same order. So I've got a standard problem. Many problems are expressed with linear equations. I've got a simple problem here. I went to the shop and I bought 2 apples and 3 pears and it cost 40 pence. And then my wife went to the shop and she bought 3 apples and 5 pears and it cost 65 pence. Okay, how much does 1 apple or 1 pear cost? That is what linear systems are. Linear equations. And as I said, that's not a particularly challenging one to do, and the outcome isn't particularly useful, but it turns out that large scientific and technical problems, such as solving partial differential equations for weather forecasting or structural analysis or all kinds of problems, end up being these matrix equations. So if I call the cost of an apple A and the cost of a pear P, I can write that as 2A plus 3P is 40, 2 apples and 3 pears cost 40 pence, and 3 apples and 5 pears cost 65 pence is 3a plus 5p equals 65. And the important point, the way that matrices work like they do, the way they're defined the way you do, is you can write that in a matrix form. So 2 apples and 3 pears is 40 pence, and 3 apples and 5 pears is 65 pence. In matrix form, it can be written as a matrix A, which is 2, 3, 3, 5, which are the coefficients, times the unknown AP is 40, 65. So the unknowns are on the left-hand side. You have a matrix A, which corresponds to your equations, and the known variables on the right-hand side. So a typical linear equation is the form AX equals B, where you know A and you know B, but you don't know X. And here, this is just that. So, and if you can, so that's our matrix times vector equals vector. That's how the problems work. So in general, we're going to be solving systems with more than two unknowns. So for a system of n equations and n unknowns, it will look like this. Just the same equations as we had, the same formula we had before for multiplying our matrix times a vector. A11x1 plus A12x2 up to A1nxn is B1 and such like. So in my previous example, n. So typically the coefficients form a matrix A with elements aij. The unknowns form a vector x with elements xi. The solution forms a vector b with elements bi. So in the previous example, n was 2. My matrix A was as given. My x1 was A and X2 was P, and my B1 was 40, and my B2 was 65. But all linear equations have the form AX equals B, and they can get very large. And so typically we'd be solving problems on a computer where N was in the thousands or tens or hundreds of thousands, millions even, not a 2x2 problem. Well, the 2x2 problem is useful as a representative. So what you might think if you've got a mathematical bent is, well, AX equals B is easy. I've got a matrix, and a lot of matrices have inverses, so I just pre-multiply that equation by A to the minus 1 AX equals, is therefore X, because A is the inverse of A to the minus 1 is the inverse of A, gives me A to the minus 1 B. So this seems very simple. So this is trivial. X equals A to the minus 1 B, that's really easy. All I need to do is compute A to the minus 1. As you remember, little formulae from school for 2x2 matrices, for a 2x2 matrix, there's this closed form for the inverse, 1 over A1, A2 minus A12, A21, A22 minus A12, A21, A11. So if we work this out, conveniently for my matrix, A12, A22 minus A12, A21 is turns out to be 1. So that first term is 1. So the inverse, instead of being 2, 3, the inverse of 2, 3, 3, 5 is just 5 minus 3 minus 3, 2. So I can multiply 5 minus 3 minus 3, 2 times my solution, and I get 5, 10. So that tells me an apple was 5 pence and a pear was 10 pence. Does that make sense? So apple was 5 and a pear was 10. So 2 apples is 10 pence and 3 pears is 30 pence. That makes 40. That looks right. 3 apples is 15 pence. 5 pears is 50 pence. So that's the right answer. Okay. So that seems easy. So we've solved the problem. The problem is, we rarely need or want to store the explicit inverse. We don't actually care what the inverse of A is, really. But the real problem is that algebraic inversion is completely impractical. Beyond the 2x2 matrix, I don't know if you remember this at school. I think I once did a 4x4 problem by hand. But I mean, the formulae grow, I think the complexity grows factorially in N, I can't remember. But it grows incredibly quickly. So it is not practical to use these closed formulae for anything other than a 2x2 or 3x3 problem. So rather than solving these problems algebraically, we solve the problems numerically. And we use numerical algorithms such as Gaussian elimination. But we can see that for very small problems, you can do it analytically because you can compute the inverse of the matrix. It wouldn't normally be nice, such a nice closed form. I've chosen a matrix that has a very nice clean inverse, but you could do it. So if you remember how I solved these things at school, the equation was 2 apples and 3 pears is 40 and 3 apples and 5 pears is 65. Well, if we double the first equation, we get 6 apples and 6 pears is 80 pence. And if we double the second equation, we get 6 apples and 10 pears is 130 pence. If we triple the first equation, we get 6 apples plus 9 pears is 120 pence. We can then subtract those equations. So what you do when you do these things by hand is you look for ways of multiplying the equations by judiciously chosen factors and then subtracting them to eliminate variables by adding multiples of one equation to another. So if I take twice the second equation and subtract 3 times the first equation, it gets rid of the apples. So I get 10 pairs minus 9 pairs is 1 pair, is 130 minus 20 is 10. So that's the right answer. And then I can substitute that back. It doesn't matter which equation I use, I'll get the same answer. But I substitute in the first equation, the apples are going to be half 40 minus 3 times the pairs. So that means gives me 5. So that's the way that I remember solving these equations at school, basically multiplying each row by some judiciously chosen factor and then adding and subtracting. And all that Gaussian elimination is a formulation, a mechanization of that. So you basically have an algorithm which just does that process but does it completely formulaically to give you the answer. Though I will take a quick look ahead. We're going to be doing this in finite precision. So imagine the two equations were actually 2 apples and 3 pears was 40 pence. And this doesn't really generalize for apples and pears, but imagine I bought 4 apples and 6.00001 pair. I'd have spent 80.0001 pence. Now, that doesn't really make sense for apples and pears, but just bear with me. If I follow the previous example, I could take the second equation and subtract twice the first one, and that would eliminate the apples. But look what it does. It gives me the equation 6.00001 minus 6 pairs. is 8.0001 minus 80. This should ring alarm bells, because we saw that that in floating point arithmetic, it's difficult to distinguish numbers that differ by a very small amount. These kind of subtractions are very prone to errors. Okay, small differences in large numbers are very difficult to represent, because to represent the large number, we need to have the decimal point way over to the right, and for small numbers, we want the decimal point way over to the left. So the value of p will come from multiplying a huge number by a tiny one. So we have a double problem here. We've got this horrible cancellation, and then we'll end up multiplying a small number by a big one. So this looks like a numerically unstable thing to do, and in fact it is. So the question is, how can we tell this will happen in advance? How can I look at my matrix? And originally it was 2, 3, 3, 5. This would have been 2, 3, 4, 6.00001. How could we have looked at that matrix and said, hold on, there's going to be a problem here? And what you can do is you can characterize these matrices by something called a condition number. And what the condition number does is it says, if you're going to solve a linear equation with this as the matrix, it gives you a measure of the range of the floating point numbers that will be required to solve the system of equations. So while you're solving these equations, What order of magnitude will these numbers scale? So there's some very, I'm just giving the slide to introduce some terminology, but you'll hear a well-conditioned problem which has a well-conditioned matrix has a small conditioned number. As you go through and solve them, all the numbers you're dealing with are of the same order of magnitude, and it's numerically easy to solve. An ill-conditioned matrix, such as my matrix 2, 3, 4, 6.00001, has a large conditioned number and is numerically difficult to solve. Mathematically, a singular matrix has an infinite conditioned number and can't be solved numerically or analytically. But we're really concerned about it. So you'll hear these terms coming up a lot. This is a well-conditioned problem. This is an ill-conditioned problem. A well-conditioned problem means it will not tend to suffer from numerical instabilities, which are introduced by the finite precision of floating-point numbers. An ill-conditioned matrix will, an ill-conditioned problem, a poorly conditioned problem, will be numerically difficult to solve because it will really stress the ability of floating-point numbers to store the range of values we need. So, for example, now, mathematically, the conditioned number is the ratio of the largest to the smallest eigenvalue. That, if you understand that, great. If it doesn't make any sense, that doesn't matter. It's really the terminology I'm introducing here. But if you compute the eigenvalues of these matrices, this first matrix has a conditioned number of 46, which is small, and the second matrix has a conditioned number of 8 million. That's saying while we're solving this problem, we'll have to deal with numbers which differ by a factor of 8 million. And that makes you think that's not going to be solvable in single precision, or it's going to give me problems. That's really not a good idea to try and tackle that problem in single precision. So, in fact, it's very hard to compute the condition number. It's actually more difficult to compute the condition number than it is to solve the equations in the first place. But there are ways of obtaining good estimates. So we'll come back to numerical libraries, but numerical libraries will tend to not only give you a good idea of the solution, but give you some idea of the condition number to give you some feeling for whether your answer is numerically trustworthy, numerically stable or not. So as I said, it gives a measure, the condition number gives a measure of the range of the scales of numbers in the problem. And if you have a condition number of order 10 to the 7, that's gonna make you nervous to try and solve that in single precision, where we can only resolve one part in 10 to the 8. So as I said, the key terminology here for linear equations is a well-conditioned matrix, which has a small condition number and numerically easy to solve. And an ill-conditioned matrix has a large condition number and is numerically difficult to solve. A singular matrix is if I said, go right back to the first slide. If I went and bought 2 apples and 3 pears and that cost 40 pence, then my wife bought 4 apples and 6 pears and that cost 80 pence. That doesn't give me any more information. If 2 apples and 3 pears cost 40 pence, if I double everything, then clearly 4 apples and 6 pears cost 80 pence. So having more than one equation doesn't necessarily give you more extra information. Okay? A singular problem is one where one of the equations is redundant. It's just some trivial multiplication of the other ones. So that's where the terminology, that's where they come from. Okay, so Gauss-Jordan elimination is as I said, if you solve these things by hand, what you do is you basically look for equations. Well, I think if I multiply that equation by 3 and subtract it from twice that equation, I get rid of one of the variables. If I remember doing this at school, Gauss-Jordan elimination is say you subtract rows of A from other rows to eliminate off diagonals. And we have to do the same on the right-hand side. But what you're doing is the formula, and this is really just a sort of a mechanization of what I did earlier on. You replace Aij with Aij minus Ai1 over A11, A1j. What you're saying here is I'm subtracting a multiple of the second equation. I'm subtracting a multiple of the first equation from the second one. Okay, so I'm concentrating on this on rows 2, 3, and 4, and I'm subtracting multiples of the first equation from those rows, and I'm picking the multiplier such that it eliminates the first variable. And in equations, that's Aij, where I is 2, 3, 4, is replaced by Aij minus Ai1 over A11 times A1j. So you're basically subtracting a judiciously chosen multiple of the first equation from all the other equations, line by line, to eliminate the other equations. And so you can do this mechanically. You can just do that for row 2, use row 1 to eliminate an equation in rows 2, 3, and 4, then use row 2 to eliminate more variables in 3 and 4 and such like. The problem with that mechanical approach is that you'll see that at this stage we have to divide by A11. The equation, we have to divide A or I1 by A11. If A11 is very small, then this number gets very big and things get unstable. And so what you there's no reason to, what I'm doing is I'm singling out this row. I'm saying I'm going to eliminate these variables, and I'm going to use this row as the master row. I'm going to subtract multiples of this row from these rows to eliminate these equations. In fact, there's no reason to pick that first row. You could pick another row. And what the technique called partial pivoting is say, well, what we do is we pick the row which has the largest value. So here I'm just mechanically picking the first row as the master row to eliminate the other variables. But in fact, I could pick the third row or the fourth row. And partial pivoting says at each stage, pick the row where the pivot value, which is the value in the first column here, is large. And that's helped stabilize the algorithm. But that's really something of a numerically it's very important, but in terms of the algorithm, it's something of a technicality. So what we can do, as I said, we take that row. In my mind, I think of it as taking that row and sweeping it down the rest of the matrix to eliminate these variables here. And so I've got primes on the right hand side because these values change. And then we just keep doing that and again and again. And as I said, as I remember doing it at school, what we did is we carried on that process. And when we then picked the second row, we eliminated all the variables in the second column. And then we picked the third row, we eliminated all the variables in the third column. And so what you end up with is on the left-hand side, you end up with a diagonal matrix. So you can use this method to reduce A to purely diagonal form. And diagonal matrices are trivial to solve because if I have a diagonal matrix times a vector equals a vector, it just becomes element-wise. That's just saying A11, X1 is B1. I have primes on these because the values have changed, but an A22, X2. That, from this, if I reduce the equation to this form, I remember I want X. I know A, I know B, but I don't know X. Though I can just read off X on the right-hand side. So that's called Gauss-Jordan elimination, and that's the method I remember using at school to solve these equations. It's a simple direct method because it's completely mechanical, and if you think about it, we know the operation count at the outset. It's of order n cubed. The complexity is of order n cubed because, if we just very simple, for eliminating the variables in a single row is order n, because we have to operate on all the elements in the row. Then we have n rows, because we have to sweep it down, so that's n squared. But we have to do that n times, and that's n cubed. So there's some multiplicative factor, but the complexity is of order n cubed. This algorithm is order n cubed. So it's pretty costly, but it's doable. However, it's an important observation. In the next slide, it may seem quite a trivial observation, but it turns out to be very important, that there's no need to eliminate all these variables in the top right-hand corner. It's actually better to reduce to upper triangular form. So technically, this is called Gauss-Jordan elimination. This is where the nomenclature gets slightly bloated, but Gaussian elimination is reducing to upper triangular form. So when I choose the second row and sweep it down, I don't bother eliminating these variables here. I just eliminate these. It's less work, okay? It's half the work. So that leaves me with a system like this. So I'm saying we operate on active submatrices of decreasing size. When we've dealt with this matrix, we then forget about it. Then we deal with this one, and then we forget about it and deal with this one. So once we've dealt with the 4x4 problem, we just then deal with the 3x3 problem and carry on. We don't bother eliminating these variables above the diagonal. And this leaves us with an equation of this form, with a system of this form. Now this doesn't look much simpler to solve than the first equation. It's a large matrix times a vector equals a vector. What have we done? But if we look, we can go, the very bottom right-hand corner, that one's easy. A44, X4 is B4. Again, they actually have prime values here because these values have changed, but I'll not read them out. So I know X4, okay? If I know X4, if I look here, well, the only thing I don't know is I know A33, I don't know X3, but I know A34, I know it. Okay, so if I start at the bottom and go up the way, this equation gives me X4, this gives me X3, then this gives me X2. So basically, this is called back substitution. It's called back substitution, you start at the end and work your way back. We can first compute X4, then X3, then X2, and all the way back up the way. And so it turns out that if you can reduce equations to triangular form, in this case, upper triangular form, then they're trivial to solve, at least simple to solve anyway. And so that sounds like a reasonable observation, and it would give you less work to do it in the when you're eliminating variables for the cost of a bit of extra work at the end. So it doesn't seem like a particularly powerful observation, but it leads on to another observation, which leads you to the real algorithm that people use for solving linear systems, which is called LU factorization. So the argument goes like this. Well, first of all, I'll recap. Gaussian elimination is a practical method. You could do it. If you really wanted to do it practically, you'd have to do partial pivoting. That means that when you want to operate on this matrix here, you have to pick one of the rows as a magic row to eliminate the other variables. I don't blindly pick this row as the magic row as I've done here. You would look down and pick the row appropriately. And it involves effectively you're reordering the rows. If you think about it, the way the rows are ordered in the matrix is somewhat arbitrary. Go right back to the start. The fact that I called the first row apples and the second row pears is somewhat arbitrary. I could have called it pears and apples, and I got a matrix where the rows were interchanged. So it's not particularly significant that you're going to change alter the rows. There's some technicalities, but it's not a big deal. So Gaussian elimination is a practical method, and the problem is, if I solve AX equals B, and then someone says, I'd like you to solve AX equals C or AX equals D, same matrix but a different right-hand size, I have to go right back to the start again. And it turns out that in real scientific computations, it's very common that you have to solve lots of equations of the form AX equals B, where A remains the same and B is different. Okay? So you have it's like saying I always buy two apples and three pears, and then three apples and five pears, but the prices change. Okay, so given that if you always that's just the way that we'll maybe see next week when we talk about the way we solve partial differential equations on a computer, but very often. In real situations, you have to solve lots of matrices, equations of the form AX equals B, where A stays the same but B changes. And that would be a bit of a problem with Gauss-Jordan elimination, or Gaussian elimination, because you'd have to go back to the start again. But we've seen the upper triangular system UX equals B is easy to solve. Okay, so U means upper triangular, so that's this diagram here. If I have a matrix U times a vector equals another vector, UX equals B, I can read off xn, then get xn minus 1 and work up the way. So imagine we could write the matrix A as the product of a lower triangular and an upper triangular matrix. Just imagine we could do that, okay? So our equation Ax equals B would be the same as Lux equals B, because Lu is equal to A, which is the same thing as setting L times Ux equals B. So if we sort of turn it on its head, if we first solve Ly equals B and then Ux equals Y, then we've solved the problem. Because if Ux equals, Ly equals B and Y equals X, then that's the same thing as Lux equals B, which is the original equation Ax equals B. Maybe we need to sit down and work that out. But what it's saying is, if I've decomposed A into the product, I haven't told you how to do this yet, but if I could make A the product of L and U, then I could solve AX equals B in two steps, solving first for a lower triangular system and then an upper triangular system. If this is the other way around, if this isn't upper triangular but lower triangular, we just read down the way. It's no harder. And the other point is that this solution method here is complexity n squared. We have n equations to solve, and each of them has n terms in it. So this forward or backward substitution step is complexity n squared. So that would be great if we could decompose A equals LU, then we could solve equations of the form AX equals B with complexity order n squared. And remember, n is going to be in the thousands or millions. So that only leaves one question, is how do we compute the L and the U factors? And all you do, and I write a 4x4 problem out, because smaller than 4x4 is too simple to illustrate the concepts. Bigger than 4x4 is too big for me to draw. So what we just say is, let's assume that we can do it. So clearly we only have n squared unknowns. So what we'll say is, let's put ones down the diagonal. We'll say L is got ones on the diagonals and then is lower triangular, and these are just zeros. And U is upper triangular. Let's just assume we could do that. Let's assume that we have A equals L U. Well, if you write it out in full, the first column is U1, 1, then L2, 1, U1, 1, L3, 1, U1, L4, 1. The second column is this thing. It's U1, 2, L2, 1, U1, 2. And we're just multiplying out this right-hand side. I said that the formula is, imagine each of the columns is a vector and just apply the standard matrix vector formulae. And I've not written out more than the first 1, 2, 3 columns because they get too complicated. And then you can just look at this and you can say, well, actually, that's good, because that gives me U1, 1. So the point is that this is equal to this. This is equal to this. So that means that top left-hand value is equal to that one. So I know U1, 1. I know U1, 2. I know U1, 3. So I can just read them off. I know that value. But that means, because I know U1, 1, this gives me L2, 1, U1, 1. Well, that means I don't know L2, 1, but I know its product, that U1, 1 times L2, 1 is A2, 1. So of this, I know A and U, so I would get L. And it turns out if you solve the equations vertically, things just fall out. So by looking at the first column, I can get all the U1, 1 and L2, 1, L3, 1 and L4, 1. Then the second column, I can get U1, 2, U2, 2, and then these things just fall out. As I go down, I know everything else that I need to know. Having done that, I can get U1, 3. If I look at the final one, my animation seems to have been a bit slow. In this final equation, I need to know L41, U13. Well, I've got that. I know L41. I've already computed that. I know U13. L42, I know. U23, I know. L43, I don't know, but I know U33. So the only thing I don't know here is this value. So if you solve the equations in this order, then you just say, look, I'll just assume I can decompose A as L times U, and then just turn the handle and see where I get. You can see that if you read off the equation in the correct order, then you can solve these equations. And so, typically, rather than storing an upper and a lower triangular matrix with lots of empty spaces, we tend to pack them into a single matrix. So you have to. This is slightly confusing because actually A is equal to L times U, but we pack them together. It makes it look like L is equal to L plus U. That's not true. A is equal to L times U. So it's just, you calculate the right-hand side in columns and you get the answers that you need. And it turns out you can also therefore do LU decomposition in place. These matrices tend to take up a lot of storage. If you're a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, it's going to take 8 megabytes of data. They get very big. And so, historically, when computers were very memory limited, it was very useful observation that if you wanted to solve the equations of AX equals B, decomposing A into an L times U matrix could be done in place, but that's something of a technicality. But the complexity of LU factorization is order n cubed, again. As we go down, if you just work it out, we have n columns to do, and each of them we have to do order n squared work. And so we end up with order n cubed. So I guess it's being a bit slow. So just to summarize, you may have to look at that again, but what this is called Crouch's algorithm. So this is where you actually solve a dense linear system's AX equals B. You first replace U by its LU decomposition. You actually use partial pivoting, which actually means that you permute the rows, but that's something of a technicality. But actually, for stability, you need to do partial pivoting. For large values of n, unless you do partial pivoting, unless you pick the correct row at each stage, then you get then things get uncontrollable. But that's, you loop over columns. This is just written in formula what I did before. You can compute uii for I up 1 to j, and lij for I is j plus 1 to n. And so if you want to see this in detail, there's a numerical recipes is a standard textbook for numerical algorithms, and it's in section 2.3 where this is covered. But other than the slight technicalities of the fact that you need to pick the correct row at each point, it is nothing more than the observation that if I write A equals L times U, I can, and I solve the equations in the correct order, I can just pick off the numbers that I need. And so if someone's asked you to solve an LU factorization, someone says, I want you to solve AX equals B, what you do is you decompose A into L and U via Kreyk's algorithm, and then you solve, again, the forward and backward substitutions can be done in place as well. So you do a forward substitution and a backward substitution, and you get the answer you need. So one of the advantages, it's stable if you implement pivoting. You only compute the LU factors once for any number of vectors B. That's the most important observation. So if someone says solve AX equals B, you have to do order n cubed work to decompose A, and then order n squared work to solve AX equals B. If someone says, now I want you to solve AX equals C, it's the same A, so you only need to do order n squared work. The very expensive part of n cubed factorization, so it's called factorization. Decomposing A into L times U is called factorizing A. These are called the LU factors. You only need to do that once. It's a couple of other observations about determinants and such like, but that really, that is the most, you know, if you want to solve AX, if anyone ever asks you to solve a large linear system AX equals B, you do it via LU factorization. The standard algorithm is called Kreyk's algorithm. But it's not magic, it's just, it's fairly easy to understand. So, interestingly, the very first example I had was x equals square root of 2. So I have this magic square root routine which just lives in some library and it gives me the square root of 2. How do I check that library is correct? Well, the easy thing I can do is I can square it and see if I got back where I started. So someone tells you there's a magic library that computes square roots. You can check if it's correct. Even if you don't know how the library works, you can check it's correct by saying, well, that's supposed to be the square root of 2. If x is the square root of 2, then x squared is 2. I can check that. It's a similar thing with these libraries. Someone will give you some library routine, and we'll see what the library is called later on. But they will say, OK, give me the matrix A and the vector B, and I will solve AX equals B. I will give you X. That's what we're trying to get. I will give you the values of all the unknowns. I will tell you how much the apples cost and how much the pears cost. But the question is, well, what was that right? OK? Well, you can check by just sticking them back into the original formula. So the analogy would have been, if I go right back to the first example of apples and pears, two apples and three pears cost 40 pence, three apples and five pears cost 65 pence. If someone had told you, well, that apples were 4 pence and pears were 11 pence, you could have said, is that right? Well, he said apples were 4 pence and pears were 11 pence. That means two apples would be 8 pence, three pairs would be 33 pence, that's 41. Well, that's not quite right, okay? So by sticking the answer back in the original equations, you can easily check if it's correct or not. And so what you should always do with these systems is to check, this is checking the accuracy, or checking that you've got the right answer. You can plug the value you get back into the original equations. So what we tend to do is, we're supposed to have solved AX equals B. We will always have some error because we can't solve these things exactly in finite precision because we're only using, at best, probably double precision numbers. So there's a thing called the residual vector R is B minus AX. It's just a difference between what you wanted to get and what you actually got. In exact arithmetic, B would be equal to AX and the residual vector would be zero. But due to numerical rounding, the residual vector is non-zero. Hopefully it's small, but it will be non-zero. But if we have a million equations, the residual vector will have a million entries. So that's a bit hard to... So what we tend to do is just compute the length of it. The root mean square, we compute the norm of the vector. We typically divide by the norm of B. But what we do, if we sum the square, we take the square root of the sums of the squares of the residual vector. So we take its length. And that will hopefully be small. Okay. Now, how small it needs to be depends on the problem you're solving, but you should always check that this is correct. You should always, whenever you solve some linear system, you call some library, it gives you an answer. It's easy for you. It only takes order n squared time, where the solution took order, at least the factorization, to order n cubed, to check that you've got the right answer. And that will pick out cases where the calculations become numerically unstable. So that's the standard thing, standard way of quantifying the error. So linear algebra is a well-constrained problem. It's very highly studied. The small set of common operations are LU factorization of one of them, and we can implement them in the library. And it's often seen as the most important HPC library. And there's actually a website called the Top 500 website, which I'll show you here, which you may have heard about, which ranks how fast all the supercomputers in the world are. So the fastest supercomputer in the world is currently in China. It's called Tianhe 2, and it has 3 million cores. That's because it's actually made up of Xeon Phi accelerators, and Xeon Phi accelerators have, depending on how you count them, but the 100 cores or something like that. But what they give is they quote its peak value. So its peak value is 50. This is in petaflops, about 55 petaflops. We saw that the UK system is about 3 petaflops, I think. So the fastest supercomputer in the world is 55 petaflops peak, but then there's a maximum, which is its maximum performance, and it's able to get about 34 petaflops. So what you do is you run a benchmark on this system and say, how fast could it solve this benchmark? And the benchmark they use is nothing more than LU factorization. However, the matrix isn't 2x2 or 4x4, it's millions by millions wide. But what the standard way of quantifying the performance of the world's largest supercomputers is to do an enormous LU factorization and then say how fast was that. Now, it does, for a number of reasons, give you an artificially inflated value. You'll see that typically the maximum speed achieved is well over 50% of the peak, which is not what you get for a real program. A real program, you're doing well if you're closer to 10% of peak. The reason is that I've mentioned this before, that what limits supercomputer speed, limits any computer speed, is memory access. Okay? Accessing memory is very slow. But if you look at this calculation, LU factorization, you have order n cubed operations, but only order n squared data. You have an n by n matrix, n squared data, but n cubed operations. So LU factorization, the computation dominates the amount of data you have to read and write. That is not typically the case in real calculations. So there are lots of arguments that this is not a particularly sensible metric, but it's the metric. I should be able to find Archer on this list. We slipped down a bit, but we're 35. So Archer is, peak speed 2.5 petaflops, and on this LINPACK benchmark, 1.6 petaflops. You'll see that this list has a lot of systems on it. But anyway, it's worth mentioning that if you hear somebody saying, "Oh, our supercomputer got such and such a performance on the LINPACK benchmark," all they meant was that it did a very large LU factorization. So I've said that here. Linear algebra is unusually efficient. Order n cubed operations for order n squared memory loads, which is not typically the number of operations is of the same. If you had n squared memory loads, real calculations, you had order n squared computations on them. But linear algebra is unusual. And so there are various libraries that implement them. They're called basic linear algebra subprograms, BLAS. BLAS level 1 is vector vector, 2 is matrix vector, 3 is matrix matrix. I've given an example. They're very old fashioned naming conventions because they were developed decades ago when they were developed for Fortran, when Fortran in the very early days had very strict You weren't allowed to have a subroutine name with more than six letters. So none of these functions have more than six letters in their names, which it makes things rather difficult and looks rather old-fashioned these days, but it's a historical artifact. So if someone tells you to solve a linear equation of the form AX equals B, you should use something called the LAPACK library. It's built on top of these BLAS libraries. It's layered on top of very efficient other libraries. And it was originally, it's designed to spend a lot, spend less time moving data around. It's designed to be efficient on modern cache-based architectures. So you should always use libraries for linear algebra. It can be quite fun to program them up yourself. It can be quite instructive, but you would not use these things in reality for two reasons. The library implementation will be much more stable. They'll have used lots of tricks and techniques to make sure that they have a numerically stable implementation. Secondly, it will be much, much faster. They will be orders of magnitude possibly faster than just naive written C or Fortran. There's also there's a parallel version, which I've not mentioned, called SCLAPACK, Scalable LAPACK. So again, if you want to solve a linear system, use the LAPACK library. If you want to solve a linear system in parallel, use the SCLAPACK library. And these are typically available on almost all systems, and there are publicly available versions of these libraries, and most systems have some bespoke libraries installed on them for optimal performance. And again, if you want to do LU factorization, you call this strange routine called SGETERF, stands for single precision general matrix triangular factorization. Again, historical reasons, all the information has to be packed into a six-letter code. Again, for historical reasons, these libraries originally written for Fortran, but their interface is to call them from Python, C, C++ now. But somewhere deep in their core, they're probably still Fortran. So this is just a little. So the LU factorization call is SGETRF, and the forward-backward substitution is called SGETRS. As I said, it's important to realize that solving a linear equation has these two phases. A, decompose the matrix A into its LU factor, such that A equals L times U. That then allows you to solve any equation of the form AX equals B. And there's just some details here which aren't particularly important, but I'll leave them up there. So summary is that dense matrices arise from linear equations. The standard notation is AX equals B. They're characterized by their condition number, and the terminology is that an ill-conditioned matrix has a large condition number. And this can lead to, we always have some errors in our solution because we're using finite precision arithmetic, but an ill-conditioned matrix, a matrix with a large condition number, will probably lead to bigger errors. And so there are ways to reduce those errors. There's iterative methods for handling those errors down, but I won't cover them here. But my main thing is you always quantify the error, okay? If someone says this library gives you the solution to AX equals B, there is no excuse for not checking at the end that AX does genuinely equal B. Some recap of the direct solution method which I talked about there. Always use libraries for linear algebra. That really is the takeaway message. So that was really what I had to say on that lecture. I don't know if there's any questions, but I was just going to go over what's up on the web for the if you wanted to look at the exercises, and I've lost my page. So what I've put up, I've covered already, that I've put up, these are the slides here. I've put up the discussion of the parallelization of the traffic model implementations and the discussion of the results from the fractal exercise. The things that you could look at this week, if you're interested, you can investigate the parallel scaling of this traffic model. This traffic model should illustrate both Amdahl's law, that for a fixed problem size, the speed up will be close to linear for small numbers of processes, but tail off for large numbers because you have a parallel and a serial part. It's maybe worth noting that you may say to yourself, well, wait a second, the way you described the parallelization of the traffic model, there was no serial part other than perhaps the I/O. But what I really mean by serial part is here is some part of the calculation whose performance does not increase as you increase the number of processes. And in fact, it's the halo swapping. If I think about the distributed memory implementation, it's the halo swapping which is that part. No matter how long your local piece of road is, you have to send a message to the left and a message to the right. You have to communicate with your neighbours. And that translates into a fixed overhead. It's not, you could argue whether it's really a serial overhead, but in terms of Amdahl's law, it doesn't matter. It's a fixed overhead which you have to pay, and it's a fixed overhead which is independent of the number of processes. Doesn't matter how many processes you run on, each process has to send a message to its two neighbours, and that translates into a fixed overhead. It also illustrates Gustafsson's law that for larger problems, that overhead becomes fractionally smaller. So larger problems should scale better than smaller problems. So you won't be able to do really large problems with the code I've sent you, because rather stupidly, I've encoded the problem size as a 32-bit integer. So you won't be able to do problems more than 2 billion cells, which actually, without rewriting the code, so apologies for that. But for moderate-sized problems, it will work. I've given you the C square root code, and the exercise this week is really illustrating. I do have LU factorization exercises, but they're not particularly fun or particularly illustrative. It's really illustrating truncation errors. So, as I said, the major source of error when you go from a mathematical model to a computer implementation is these truncation errors, which involves the fact that you can't solve things continuously, you have to solve them discretely. So I gave the example of a grid for a climate simulation. What this does is this exercise simulates the orbit of a comet or some heavenly body around the sun. And of course we know that when a body orbits the sun, it moves continuously. But to simulate it on a computer, we can't do that. We have to move it in little steps. And that's our discrete step. We move it, instead of it moving continuously, we update it every 5 minutes, 10 seconds. We have to take lots of little steps to move it round. And that's where the truncation error comes from. The fact we have a finite step size introduces the truncation error. And this exercise allows you to see how different algorithms have different truncation errors. And it's really there to show you that it's really the truncation error which is very important. If you can have an algorithm where the error is proportional to the time step squared, the time step being a small number, the time step squared is a very small number, that is really massively superior to a more naive algorithm where the error is proportional to the time step. So what the code does, it implements two very similar algorithms, but one is quite naive and the error is proportional to the time step. The other is slightly more sophisticated. The error is proportional to time step squared. And by playing around with that, you can you can see these issues. And it also illustrates how you check a calculation in reality. One of the checks I gave you for the traffic model was make sure none of the cars disappear. You start off with 57 cars, you'd end up with 57 cars. In a physical simulation like planets orbiting the sun or a comet orbiting the sun, a classic quantity which should be conserved is the energy, the total energy. Energy can't be created or destroyed, so you can compute the total energy of the simulation and it should be fixed. Now, due to numerical rounding errors, it will be slightly different. Sorry, due to truncation errors, apologies, the truncation errors, it will not be exactly conserved. But that gives you a handle on how accurate was my simulation. Well, you know, how well did it conserve the energy? And you can investigate, you know, if I double the time step, half the time step, how does that vary? And the exercise, although that sounds fairly qualitative, and you get nice pictures of orbits around the sun, the actual exercise is a quantitative one, where what I want you to do is to basically plot the error in the energy and see the error will depend on some power of the time step, and by numerical experiments and plotting a graph, you can work out what the dependency is. And if the code works correctly, you should be able to see that the error for the naive algorithm, which is called the Euler algorithm, is linear in the time step. Here, m is 1. But for a more sophisticated algorithm called the leapfrog algorithm, it's a second order method. So the error should be proportional to the time step squared. And that translates into enormous savings in time. Okay, if you can do a simulation with a time step which is a hundredth of another, if one algorithm can get an equally accurate answer with a time step which is 100th of another one, it will be 100 times faster. Okay, think about that. So I can't show you the pictures because this is a Windows machine. I can't show you the graphics, but it should work out the box. I have C and Fortran implementations there, and you should be able to play around and get some nice pictures of there are two situations set up. One is where a comet comes in, orbits the Earth, the Sun, sorry, and goes away, and that's an open orbit. The comet comes in from infinity, comes around, and then disappears again. Or there are closed orbits, which are more like planets going around the Sun. So you can see the planets going round and round and round, and the standard graphing packages there to look at the answers. So that's all I had to say. Next week, what I'm planning to do is, there's a slight change in the original timetable. I've postponed something I was going to do this week to next week. But what I'm hoping to do next week is go back to the timetable. I'll cover particle methods I've probably very briefly talk about. But what I'll really concentrate, I'll cover partial differential equations very quickly, but only in as much to motivate, to link with this week, to show you that if you solve differential equations on a computer, they turn into matrix equations, which kind of hopefully motivates why we looked at those today. But what I'll mainly talk about is random number and Monte Carlo, and a bit about the thing I've moved is linear optimization packages. I'll talk about that next week. I moved that from this week. But I'll talk about random numbers, Monte Carlo simulations, and optimization packages, and hopefully be able to explain at least the concepts behind Markov chain Monte Carlo methods and why they're used, what they're trying to do, and what problems they can solve. Okay, so hope to see you next week. Thanks.